I'm KP.
And this is Tamil. Our talk is about how to get started with OpenGL programming in Android. It's more about OpenGL than anything specific to Android. The structure of our talk is going to be like this. So initially we're going to talk something about some basics about OpenGL, and then we're going to directly jump into some code. We will be trying to explain today as while we go through the code is a simple OpenGL application which draws some basic shapes and then does some basic animation using that. Okay. So, what is OpenGL? Most of the computing systems available today has a dedicated hardware specifically for processing graphics. OpenGL is a library which gives you access to this dedicated hardware. So what that means is most of the processing that is done in OpenGL programming, the programs which uses OpenGL is in the GPU rather than in the CPU. And the GPU is a dedicated hardware which is highly optimized for executing graphics instructions. And another advantage of you have multiple choices if you want to do this, such as you have DirectX in Windows and similar stuff. One advantage of OpenGL is that it is highly it's available across different platforms, such as Windows, Mac, Linux. There is an OpenGL implementation for almost all the platforms that I know. And OpenGL ES. OpenGL ES is a stripped out version of OpenGL which is available for the desktop. This is something that is highly optimized for embedded devices such as mobiles and consoles. This again, OpenGL ES can be defined as a strict subset of OpenGL desktop version. We have different versions in both in OpenGL and OpenGL ES, such as OpenGL ES 1.1 and 1.2, and there are some major differences in that. We'll get to that later. Like OpenGL ES2 is available for a wide variety of platforms. That means the programs, even if you create an OpenGL based program for Android, without much difficulty you can use it for say iOS 2. Some very basic concepts related to computer graphics. This is for people who have who are new to 3D graphics and such. Vector graphics. Before I started with OpenGL, the graphics meant to me, what graphics meant to me was what Photoshop was. Basically, computer graphics can be classified into two different types. One is vector graphics and one is raster graphics. What happens in vector graphics is you try to build the objects in your scene with a set of very simple primitives, such as lines, polygons, and surfaces, etc. So what that means is if you want to show a sphere, you try to build it using much simpler surfaces. So what you get is an approximation of a sphere. The more number of objects, elements you have, you get a better approximation. And raster graphics, this is what most of us are used to. What we deal with here is a grid of pixels, such as what is there in this is what you do when you do something in Photoshop. One simple way that I can explain is if you, in better graphics, you can explain a circle using just the center point and the radius. That is all the data that you need to represent a graphic which contains a circle. But whereas in a raster graphic, you need the entire bitmap with different colors for the circle. So what this means is if you want a bitmap with higher quality or a larger size, you need more storage. But whereas in vector graphic, all you need to store is the center point as well as the radius. It doesn't matter what the radius is, even if it is a huge circle, you still just store these two values. So that is one major difference between vector graphics and raster graphics. So in OpenGL, you use both these concepts. You use vector graphics to actually define the objects in your scene. So initially you define the objects in a 3D space, and then as part of the OpenGL rendering, finally you render this to a screen. That's where the raster graphics comes into picture. Also, this will be used when you apply textures to a surface. We'll come to that later. Okay, Tamil, you continue.
Hi everybody. As KB mentioned, OpenGL is the combination of both vector graphics and raster graphics. So how those vector graphics and raster graphics come into play in OpenGL? That's what we are going to see now. OpenGL actually performs so many steps that happens in GPU. So you don't have to worry about that now. So we have just simplified the flow of what happens with the OpenGL and GPU. Initially, to draw anything on screen, what you have to define is you have to define what objects you are going to draw and how you are going to draw. So those are the data that you have to provide to the OpenGL. That is the first step. What you see there is data. So after you provide the data, OpenGL will convert them into shapes. For example, you have a square. You define that with four vertices. So what you give to OpenGL is that you give the vertices to OpenGL and say that those four points refer to a square. So what OpenGL will do is it will convert them into its internal representation. That is what happens in vector operation stage. And then the next step, rasterization. With only the vector objects, you cannot directly display it onto the screen. So OpenGL actually is a 3D graphics, right? So we have to map the 3D objects into the 2D screen. So that is where the raster graphics come into play. We convert 3D objects into 2D pixel representation. Farer objects will be smaller in size when you look at a 2D screen, right? So those kind of things will happen in rasterization. And then comes the fragment operation. There you can there what OpenGL does is it will decide what color to render in each pixel. You just define the objects for now. For example, we defined a square and it is rasterized to 2D screen, but you will know what color it will display. So that will happen in fragment operation. Finally, it is being displayed to, it's being rendered to frame buffer, which can be either targeted to a screen or to a texture. That will, those are the advanced topics which we will not cover now. There's one more thing to OpenGL. OpenGL is not like traditional programming, like whatever object-oriented programming that we use. It is a state machine. I guess everyone would know what a state machine is. State machine will maintain its state, state until some transition occurs by some commands. So OpenGL will also do the same. For example, if you want to draw a line with some color, so you will set the state to back, line color as red or something, and then you call it draw function. So it will use the previously existing state. So until you change the state, whatever you draw, it will use the same color. So that is the state machine. So this is one important concept that everyone has to remember while programming in OpenGL, because you cannot visualize things in object-oriented form in OpenGL. So that is one important step. I'll hand over to KP now.
Getting into actually drawing a shape with the basic shape. This is some setup that we need to do specific to Android. There are different version of OpenGL ES. There's OpenGL ES 2 and then the previous versions. What we're going to use today is OpenGL ES 2. And if you want to use OpenGL, you have to give this use feature in Android manifest file. That's similar to giving permission for normal Android apps. And for normal views, what we use in Android is surface view or surface view. But for rendering using OpenGL, what Android provides is the GL surface view. Why is it needed? It's pretty obvious. You are trying to render something onto the screen, so you need some class which will handle that surface for you. That is what the purpose of GL surface view is. And that's what GL surface view. It doesn't do a lot. It basically handles surface onto which you're going to draw. And the actual this is the code snippets which describes the scene. We're creating a GL surface view, and we're setting the context client version. Since we're using OpenGL ES version 2, we're setting that to 2, and then we are setting a renderer. The surface, the GL surface view itself doesn't take care of rendering the actual graphic. That is something that we need to do. So what we basically do is we create a subclass of GL surface view.renderer, and then add our logic which uses OpenGL to render the graphic. So you create a subclass and then finally set that renderer to the GL surface view. So the GL surface view will use this renderer to actually render the content. This is what I just said. Okay. Most of the work that happens in OpenGL is done inside the renderer. Actually, most of the work is done, almost all of the work is done here. So here, what we are trying to do is, there are three major callbacks in the renderer. One is the surface created on draw frame and on surface changed. On surface created is called each time the view is created, and on draw frame for each for rendering a single frame. And on surface changed is called whenever the dimensions of the window in which the surfaces get changed. So what we are doing here is nothing much. We're just setting a clear color. As Tamil had already mentioned, OpenGL is a state machine. So normally, if you want to clear, draw some color or set a background color, you'll set background color and color. So instead of that, what we do here is first you say set color and then you say clear. For you can see that the GL clear method doesn't take any parameter for the color that has been set previously. So each time when you call GL clear, it will clear to whatever color you have previously set. So if you want to change it, you should explicitly do that. And then visiting the viewport, it describes which even if you have an entire window, you might not actually want to render to the entire window. You might want to take only a part of it. But in this case, what we are doing is we're passing the entire width and height. So that means that we'll render to the complete window. And that's it. This is very basic. Okay, so after you run this, this is what you actually get. So we do have some sample apps, so we'll show you some demo. This is the sample app which does similar stuff to what we have done in this shown in the slides. Same. So I'll just run this app. See what it does. And that is the output. This is not a big deal, but this is a starting point. So without any surface or clearing it, you can't do anything. So we got the surface in place. Now we'll move on to drawing some stuff on the screen. Okay? As I mentioned earlier, we have to provide some sort of data to the OpenGL for it to understand and create the objects. For example, I said square, right? Square can be represented with four words. So that vertex is actually a primitive, using which you can define the square. Same way, there's something called as edge. Lines that join the vertex, that is called as edge. And there is something called face. Which is more than two vertices. When you have more than two vertices, then it can form a complete shape. Right? For example, triangle is a closed shape. So those things will be called as face. Right? So these are the primitives with which you will be defining the objects for drawing to the screen. Okay. Here we have a square sample data which will be passing to the OpenGL. OpenGL usually has the coordinate system starting from minus 1 and ending at 1. It's both x and y axis starts from minus 1 and ends at 1. Okay? So everything that we define within OpenGL will be in floating point values. Okay? So here we have defined a circle which starts from bottom left, minus 0.5 to minus 0.5. So even if you understand the primitive, yes. So the coordinates which we have already shown, we'll be storing that in a float array. But float array is not very efficient in terms of graphical browsing. So what OpenGL will do is, it will accept a byte buffer which is optimized for storage. So byte buffer and all the stuff for a specific talent, so we are not going to cover that now. We are just passing the coordinates. We are just storing the coordinates into a buffer, and we will use that buffer to pass it to the OpenGL. Okay. Now we have the data, and we have to tell OpenGL to draw it. Right? So we need some sort of commands to make the OpenGL draw some stuff. So those commands are gl draw arrays and gl draw elements. Gl draw arrays, what it does is, we have already created an array, you have seen. Right, and for defining a square, you define the vertices. So that is the data that will be stored in an array. So it will pick all those values in that array, and it will draw it into the screen. So that is the purpose of GL draw arrays. And there is one more function for called GL draw elements. This will come into play when you have complex shapes to draw.
example, if square is simple, you can easily mention the points. But when you have complex shapes which have the vertices, then you will use GL diagrams. But that will take more time to explain, so we will just move on to the important stuff for now. So we now have vertices, 0.5 and those kind of stuff we have. But how do you tell OpenGL, how is it related, those points are related to each other? We know that it is square, but how will OpenGL know those points form a square? So for that we need to define using some sort of primitives. So those primitives are listed in the page. I'll show you a slide here. These are the examples for primitives. When you say points, each vertex refers to a single point on screen. So OpenGL blindly will draw the points. But if you say GL lines, if you have 10 vertices, what it will try to do is it will try to draw lines with each vertex point. For every 2 points, it will draw a discrete line. The same way with line strike. Line strike will not try to draw discrete lines, it will draw a continuous line. The same goes with the triangles and a triangle strike, triangle fan. I think you can understand by the diagram. Now I will hand over to KP and he will explain the process.
So what Tamil was explaining is how you pass the data about the objects in this scene to OpenGL. Along with this, you also, when you have complex scenes, you also pass the geometry of different objects along with their orientation too, and the camera position, all these things. Based on all these things, you need to all these the vertices and the vertices, the camera position, the projection in which that you are using, such as orthogonal perspective. All these things are described using matrices. So all these things comes as part of the data, but then you have to apply all these transformations and you have to finally figure out the final orientation and position of the object. That is done in the second step, that is vector operations. And these vector operations is carried out in the hardware. So whatever we've been talking till now, such as setting all these buffer arrays, everything that happens in the CPU. But actually calculating the final positions of each vertex and their orientation, that happens in the GPU. So that is what is there in the vector operations section. Rasterization, we already discussed, finally converting into 2D screen and all. And then fragment operations, you calculate the pixel value for each point of this screen. So until OpenGL ES2, the stages starting from vector operations were fixed. That means you set the values and then OpenGL takes care of it. You didn't have any control over it. But since OpenGL ES2, you have control over that. You can write programs which will affect how these operations are carried out. Mostly vector operations as well as the fragment operation, these two sections. So that is where shader programs comes into picture. We have two different types of shader programs that we use. One is a vertex shader and one is a fragment shader. A vertex shader is a program which executes for each vertex and the object. So in this case, we are trying to draw a square. So it executes 4 times. Whereas fragment shader is a program which the purpose of vertex shader is to is basically to figure out the final orientation of the object. Whereas what fragment shader does is it gives the actual color for each pixel inside the object. So it executes for each pixel that is inside the object. And for a fragment. So that basically means that a fragment shader exhibits much more often than what a shader. Since it exhibits in GPU, these operations are mostly done parallelly, and that is taken care of by GPU. So this is the flow that we have to follow. First, you create shader objects, and then you attach each. You have a program for vertex shader and fragment shader. Actually, this is a language, but vertex shader and fragment shader is written in a language that is very similar to C. You create those programs and then attach it to the shader program. And then finally, you link that so that it can be executed in the GPU. So we'll show you. So this is the same diagram which explains these steps. You have vertex shader, you have fragment shader. Then you compile it. Then you attach it, and you get a program object. And then you link it, and then you get a final executable. And then this program is finally executed in the GPU. Okay, vertex shader. What this vertex shader program does is something similar to what the pre-OpenGL ES2, what used to happen in pre-OpenGL ES2. We get the attribute vector position that gives the current position of the, as I said earlier, this vertex program, the vertex shader executes for each vertex in the object. For each vertex, it gets the input, the current position of the vertex. So in this case, the output is the final position. That is what we are assigning to GL position. In this case, we are not doing anything other than directly outputting the same value. And for fragment shader, this executes for each pixel. So what we are doing is we are setting the same color for all pixels inside the square. So these are the before you can actually use the shader program, these are the steps that you have to do. This is the actual code which does the stuff that I talked previously about. So initially you're creating a shader. So here you use the constant GL vertex shader, so that OpenGL knows that you're trying to create a GL vertex shader. So you get a handle to that, and then you attach the source code. In the client program, it will just be a string. But then once you compile it and link it, like it can actually execute in the GPU. So the next two statements, what it basically does is it attaches the source code, and then you compile it. And then you need to do all this again for fragment shader. The steps are the same, but then you use a different variable while creating shader, which tells OpenGL that you're trying to create a fragment shader. So you've created the program. Now you attach, created the main program object with the GL create program. You attach both vertex and fragment shader to that, and then you finally link it. Now you have something that can be executed in the GPU.
As KP explained, we have been just created the shader program that can be executed in the GPU. Okay. Those steps are similar to what we already do in normal program. Once we have the program in shader, our Android app actually runs in a different browsing unit. GPU and our Android's browsing unit are different. So how do you communicate between these two? So that's what we are going to see now. So you have an executable program, and you have variables there, like vertex version, for example. So when you want to access that variable in your Android app, then you have to get a handle to the
that attribute in the executable shaded block. That is done by the jailgate attribute location function. It will give you the position of that particular attribute in the shader program. So using this, you can get the location. This is similar to pointer, but pointer between two different programs. After getting the pointer, you can use OpenGL methods to assign or get values from those values. So here, what we are doing is to draw the square. You have to pass the vertices to the OpenGL shader program. As we already explained, vertex shader will be executed 4 times. So how does it know it should be executed 4 times? So we are passing an array of vertices, that is square vertex buffer, which we have already created. Based on that, it will execute 4 times. And we are enabling that vertex attribute array, and we are drawing it to the screen. GL draw arrays will draw the triangle stripe 4 times. Okay, this is what is it happens. As we mentioned, it is a state machine. So how does the GL draw array know what values to draw? So that is what we do by enabling the vertex attribute array. Whatever you enable, it knows that those are the arrays the draw array method should execute. This is the output, but this doesn't look like a square, is it? So this is basically because of the projection matrix that will come to later. But we'll show the output in now. We will just show you the output for this particular app which I mentioned. The square is displayed as a rectangle, but that we need to correct it, because as I mentioned, OpenGL uses square coordinates since the we have already shown starts from minus 1 to 1. So when you map that square coordinates to a device screen which is rectangular, you will get this kind of output. Device size vary with each device, so we have to adjust for those values. That is being done using using projection and camera views that we won't get in detail once, since we are running out of time. What these projections will do is that it will adjust for the screen size, whatever proportions you mentioned. For example, the square or rectangle, whatever size you mention, it will keep up the proportions on any screen. So these are the methods that defines the projections. First term defines the perspective projection. Perspective is near and far objects will look different when you look different in a 2D screen. That's what we define in matrix.firstTime. And setLookup will define where you are looking at the object. This is like more like a camera, setting a camera in front of the 3D image. After we create the transformation for all those projections, we are passing those projection matrices to the vertex shader to use it for normalizing the square. The square was displayed as a rectangle. Now, since we passed the projection, all the calculations that needed to be done to make the square look like a square, that will be taken care of here. When you multiply the MVP matrix with the vertex version, it will modify the... It is the same. The one additional thing that we have to do is we have to pass the matrices that we have just calculated to correct the output. This is it. Now it will look more like a square. That. This is the output. We just added a matrix that corrects the output depending on the screen. That's it. One more step that we can, we wanted to show you was the animation path.
Animation part, we have to add some more translation to the object. Now we define the square, but when you try to rotate it, you have to change the vertices to some other location. That can be easily done with matrix calculations. That's what we do by using matrix.setRotation. That will randomly set the, for now we are randomly setting the angles. So what it will do is it will rotate the square that we have defined based on the time. So we'll show that in output. We don't have to worry about calculating the new points for rotating. For every rotation, we need to find new points that that needs to be drawn. But using matrix, we just start to define what rotation we need. And if you multiply that with the objects, it will rotate. The frame rate in the screen is very low, so you can, this is the actual output. Okay. So that's pretty much it. This is actually a getting started tutorial. We just wanted to make you feel comfortable that OpenGL is not a very tough thing to do. Once you get started, it will be very easy. So.
Okay, we just have time for one question. Yeah.
What about hidden shapes? In case you have a triangle for which there's another triangle, then you know, show only part of the triangle which is very correct. So, you have to do the calculation.
That calculation that will happen based on the location. There is one more axis for axis called Z, right? Z will define where that is positioned. For example, X and Y defines only two-dimensional square, but there is something called Z axis which will define where the object is positioned. So you can easily do that in OpenGL.
I'm sorry to cut the question short. They will be available at the venue. You can just contact them. Thank you for your presentation.